Carl. Happy Halloween to all of you Pipe Pals out there. Pipe Pals and Pipe Gals. Well, it's old Holy Smoking Pipe Padre. How are you doing this evening? Well, right now I'm making this early, late morning, actually. And I'm smoking my Robert Burns Macaulay Halloweeny pipe. Very appropriately, my October pipe again. Many of you have commented on this pipe and said, hey, that's a neat looking pipe. Where do you get a pipe like that? Well, I got this at the Briar Patch about 3 or 4 years ago. There was an estate sale of some estate pipes at the old Arden Fair Mall. Sad to say it's no longer there. But Matthew and Sean and Chris, Woody, all those guys that were there then. Anyway, so, but I think it was Sean who introduced me to the Robert Burns Macaulay pipe. So there you go. And it's, I've always called it my Halloweeny pipe. Looks like something from a Halloween fantasy, Alice in Wonderland kind of a thing. So I just love this thing. Beautiful pipe. And she's a good smoker. She's a good girl. Anyway, I'm smoking, again, what I think is probably one of my most favorite Halloween blends, and it is Sillam's Black. Sillam's Black, I'm holding up right, is a perfect hybrid marriage, if you will, between an aromatic and an English. Now, many of you know I love my pirate cake, and I maybe later this evening, we'll do a little pirate cake, possibly, for the trick-or-treaters. More trick for them and treat for me. Yes, pirate cake. I think even Herman and Ayer said his wife would not let him in the house with pirate cake. He has smoked that outside. So, Herman, if you're watching, hello there. Guten Abend to you. Well, happy All Hallows Eve to you, and happy All Saints Day, which is tomorrow. Some of you are watching it now, so happy All Saints Day to you. So I just wanted to get on here with a little bit of coffee. And just reminiscing about October 30 and 31st have always been kind of rather significant dates in my life. 17 years ago today, I was on my way to Bosnia. I was in the army and I was on my way downrange. And we were driving a bus into Bosnia. And so anyway, it was like a 25, 30 hour bus ride. Wasn't fun. We got there about 10 o'clock on the evening of October 31st. We left the morning of October 30th, about 4:30 in the morning. And it was a very long and very tiring bus ride. Anyway, so so October 30th and 31st have always been kind of really interesting days in my life. Days where some real change was definitely going on. Anyway, so today hopefully will be more of an uneventful kind of a day. It is here in my part of the world. It's a rather warm day today. Although it's supposed to be cooling off, and we hopefully will be getting some real rain coming this week. Let's hope. Hope and pray. Okay, well, I just wanted to... one of my longtime viewers and, I'd say, friend, Gary Portier. This is why I'm trying to do a screen flow. I tried to do the screen flow earlier, and it didn't work. So we're going to try it again, see if this is going to work. I'm going to go here, and I'm going to go here. Here we go. Great. Okay. So we're going to talk about a couple of things. Gary is the gentleman scholar. Is a very interesting fellow because he always likes to write cards, longhand letters. And he always creates his own kind of cards. This, I guess, is a Halloween card. Very appropriate. Very well done. But he's a person, he's a very artistic person, I would say. And he just likes to create things. And he's also, like some of my other friends, really into science fiction and fantasy things. And he probably could tell you more than you want to know about almost any kind of comic book or gothic novel. But anyway, Gary's a real big comics kind of guy. So we share a lot of little asides from time to time. And also we're devotees of Fargo. Second season got it started not too long ago. Anyway, so but Gary is always keeping in touch, always making comments and stuff. So anyway, the other day, as I was reading some of the post reviews of the Synod of the Family, I came across this particular, oops, no, that's a different one. I came across this one here, how Pope Francis is stealthily reforming the most conservative institution on earth. And I read this. And a couple days ago, Gary sent me a heads up saying, hey, have you seen this article? And what do you think of it? So I thought I would take some time and talk about this article. Not in real depth. I actually made a video about an hour ago thinking I was recording, and unfortunately it did not, the ScreenFlow did not record. So I'm very disappointed in that. Try it one more time. If it doesn't work, I've got some other projects that I've got to do today. Plus I have to get ready for the weekend, and I have to come up with some ideas for All Saints Day as we celebrate All Saints Day this weekend in the calendar, liturgical calendar of the church. So I've got to try to have something to say tonight. So I thought I would start off, though, permit me to put my reading glasses on here, this article here, nun excommunicated for becoming a priest. I guess this is a, the Daily Beast. I think this is a UK, publication. I could be wrong, but I think I'm right. So anyway, this story came out about another lady who has sought to become a quote-unquote ordained Catholic priest. And so they talk about, and again, I'm going to have to try to recreate what I said last video, and I'm a little bit kind of like trying, because I had a certain way I put these two articles together. But anyway, it says, let's just take with the title, Nun Excommunicated for Becoming a Priest. Well, now it might seem like, oh gosh, the evil Vatican is beating up on this poor elderly woman who wants to become a Catholic priest. Well, actually, that nothing could be further from the truth. The only thing the Vatican probably would say, if they've said anything at all, and I think maybe the local bishop would say, is that, sorry, we don't recognize her ordination. Now, has Pope Francis come out with a papal bull excommunicating this individual woman? No, not at all. But there are certain actions that we take on our own initiative that if we do them, we are taught by the church that we are excommunicated, what's called laete sententiae, that is by the very act of what we do. So again, there are certain actions that do mean that we are excommunicated. Now, so she tried to become a Catholic priest, and we know that the Catholic Church does not permit or recognize, I should say, the ordination of women to the priesthood. So when you try and go against the clearly established teachings of the church, then you are putting yourself in opposition. Basically, what this really boils down to, and I'll just summarize it by saying it this way, the pride of this woman got the better of her. Now, the thing that we have to remember, and then the article that talks about how, what is that? New prime rib shrimp mix? Ooh. Sometimes they throw in the weirdest commercials in some of these articles. I don't know if you've noticed that. I know I have. But basically, it tries to beat up on the church for not recognizing this woman's ordination. I don't know this person. I have nothing against her, except that she is just misguided. There are other denominations that recognize the ordination of women, And my humble opinion and encouragement to her was, okay, you know well that the church, this is a teaching of the church. It does not ordain women. Now, you may agree or disagree with that, but that's where the church is. Even Pope Francis has said recently, it was about a month or two ago, that the door is closed on that issue. It's not up for discussion. Sorry. So she feels that she's being excluded, that something's being denied from her that she has a right to. And I would say, okay, there comes a point in our lives when we have to get real and say, okay, is it worth fighting City Hall? I had a friend of mine who was a sponsor of mine one time. He says, when are you going to learn? You can't fight City Hall and win. That's an old saying, but it's true. But there are other denominations out there that would probably welcome this lady and actually probably put her to work. And she'd probably even find not only a vocation, but a job as being a real priest in another denomination. So I would say, instead of trying to beat your head against the wall, which causes frustration for you, must cause a lot of grief and frustration in your heart and soul, why don't you go to a community that's going to accept you, celebrate you, and employ you for your beliefs, instead of trying to fight this change, which in her lifetime is never going to happen. And the bottom line is it probably can't happen, and I'm going to explain that in another, when I address the other article here in a minute. But she kind of claims that somehow the church is basically being a big bully, a big meanie, and not giving her what she wants. We have to remember that the mission of the church is not to provide people with offices or titles. You know, priest, father, reverend, put me let me do all these specialized things. That's not what the church is about. The church, the Catholic Church, is about one thing really and one thing only, and that's about the salvation of our souls. And we don't hear a lot about that anymore simply because we are so focused on the temporal order of the church, the bureaucracy of the church. And so we have to, I think, uncouple ourselves, or at least put back the component of that sense of we're pilgrims passing through this life. And we are called to salvation, okay? And all men and women, regardless of your whatever standing you are, whatever vocation you are, whatever you've done wrong in your life, we are all called to repentance, conversion, and salvation. That's the gift of the church, not ordination, not giving you a special role to do. Now, again, we focused an awful lot in the church about social justice and ministering and all these things. Well, and that's important. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that's not important. But that's not the true mission of the church. The church's mission is one of salvation, and that's opened to everybody, including this lady here. So unfortunately, if you were to take the analysis and say, well, she recognizes on one level that it goes against the fundamental doctrines and teachings of the church, so she's the one who, in essence, is at fault here, or bears the responsibility of trying to force an issue that has already been told, sorry, but no, this is a closed door to you, okay? Even Pope Francis has said that. So, although I can be somewhat sympathetic and understand when we try to fight something that we feel is wrong, at the end of the day, you know, it's probably a waste of her time, her life, to try and continue this when she could find a congregation that would accept her. And she could be doing some pretty good things instead of causing a lot of anguish for herself, frustration for others. Now, this other article that I want to talk about briefly, I can't talk about the whole thing. In fact, I'm going to be able to make sure that this works. In fact, you know what we're going to do? I'm going to pause it here just to make sure that the screen flow is working, okay? So I'm going to go here, back to screen flow, turn it off, and then see if it's working, okay? Okay, it looks like that first video did take, so we're going to we're going to go do this and coming go up, back to this. Okay, hopefully that works. So I'm doing ScreenFlow, as you can see, which allows you to do screen capturing if you're interested. It's a program from Telestream, I think, is the company, and it's like $99. So, but if you like doing ScreenFlow, you like doing tutorials, you like doing, you know, I see a guy named Dom Bauer in Scotland, which I like his videos, but anyway, he does a lot of ScreenFlow stuff. He talks more about veganism, and so he will get on here and talk about certain articles or certain videos. So he does ScreenFlow and screen capture. So that's why I knew this about ScreenFlow about 6-7 years ago. Guy named, Apple Soldier, whatever, old Emeek 77, young guy who was a really whiz kid when it came to Final Cut Pro and Shake and Motion, did a lot of great tutorials. Haven't seen much from him in the last few years. But anyway, he did a screen. He introduced me to ScreenFlow a long, long time ago, so that's why I use ScreenFlow. Okay. And there are other video capturing programs out there. Some are, I don't know if they're free, but they're probably not as expensive. But ScreenFlow has got a lot of really good, simple, easy interface to use, and it's good for the most part. Okay, so this article here is about, you know, how Pope Francis is stealthily reforming the most conservative institution on earth. And this was sent to me as a link by Gary. He wanted to know if I had seen this, and of course I had seen it and read it a couple days before he sent it to me. So what this article is about is simply that the Pope is going to, you know, change the church, and but he's going to do it in kind of this stealthy kind of manner, which is interesting. Let me kind of close out of that there. There we go. Kind of get more of a big screen there. Okay, so basically, again, what we're talking about are these kinds of things here, these issues right here. Again, artificial contraception, also read abortion, allowing married priests, sanctifying same-sex marriages, and ordaining women. Well, we'll take the last one first. Again, Holy Father, Pope Francis has said that door is closed. He said that door is closed because the church has spoken. The church says no. Okay, so we're just going to just take that one off the table because it's not on the table. All right. Sanctifying same-sex marriages. Guys, I know there's some of you out there who will be sad to hear this, but it's in the same line as the women priest. It's just not going to happen. Okay. That's something that, you know, I know it comes as a hard saying, but again, sometimes it's better to be honest and forthright and just explain that right off the top and say that's just not going to happen. Now, allowing married priests. Now, believe it or not, we actually do have, in the Roman Catholic Church, we have married priests. In fact, I think I just saw an article. Let's see here. I just saw this article. Was it on here? Just trying to see. There was an article about a guy who is a married man, Lutheran, I believe. Oh, no, Anglican, who is becoming an ordained Catholic priest. Okay? So, here's the thing. People would make the mistaken understanding that, oh, if Pope Francis says priests can get married, then priests can get married. No. And this is subtle, but it's very profound. Priests can't get married. So if the Pope came out and said, you know, because people say, well, this would benefit you, then you could get married. Old buzzard that I am, I don't think anybody would want me, but that's okay. That's for another day topic we'll talk, maybe never, probably never. But the bottom line is that, okay, I couldn't get married. But we'd have married priests. Well, we would have married priest, yes, but priests couldn't get married. Now, let me explain that. It has to do with the order of vocations. So we do have, and I have, one of my friends is a quote-unquote married Catholic priest. And, you know, not a renegade guy and some other, you know, offshoot kind of a quasi-Catholic thing. No, not at all. He's in our diocese. In fact, I think we have a couple. I only know of one. But anyway. So the thing is that you can be a married man and apply to become ordained as a Catholic if you were ordained in another church before, and you were ordained and married in another church, like a Lutheran. If you're like a Lutheran, Episcopalian, Eastern Orthodox, I believe even. So if you were already a married ordained minister in that particular denomination and you convert to the Catholic faith, then you could become a married priest. And so, and that the term is you were married first, and then the holy orders of priesthood is now, then you enter into that vocation as well. But you cannot be a priest and get married. Okay? It doesn't work that way. But married men in the Eastern Rite, the Orthodox Church, are married, and then they receive the sacrament of holy orders after they receive the sacrament of holy matrimony. So that's the way it works. Because if you're an ordained priest, you can't get married. That's just the way it is. And I'm perfectly happy with that. It's not a problem. So anyway, it doesn't mean that I wouldn't enjoy being married. It doesn't mean I don't have a desire to be with somebody and to have a family. It doesn't mean that at all. It's just that I understood that when I became a Catholic and then later became a priest. And, you know, okay. It's not always easy. No, there are times you get lonely. There are times it would be nice to have a spouse. Absolutely. But I have accepted that as a part of the greater good of my vocation. Besides, I got to be honest. I don't think my wife would let me smoke pirate cake in the house. I believe my dear friend Ehrman, the Erminator, in Deutschland said that his wife absolutely forbids him to smoke pirate cake, not only in the house, but probably even anywhere near the house. So anyway, it's not a fair trade, but at least there is some consolation. I can smoke pirate cake in my house. Not to say that's a great thing, but I'm just saying there are some perks. Okay. So anyway, but this article goes on to say that Pope Francis is going to somehow bring about this change, but he's going to do it in this kind of stealthily, subtle way. And the way he's going to do it, according to the article, and you can go read the article, is basically he's going to say, well, what they're going to do instead of him making the decision, quote unquote, that he's going to now lighten up all these rules and change the rules or whatever, he's basically going to let it fall to the bishops of dioceses and basically the bottom front row, the infantryman, if you will, in the field, the poor parish priest is going to be the one to be the final arbiter, if you will, to make this decision, because he'll be like the boots on the ground kind of guy. You know, he'll be the face to face with the real people in the real life situations, and somehow the parish priest will be much more pastoral and much more, you know, merciful, and he'll just basically say it's okay. So the bottom line is that they think that, you know, the church's teaching on artificial contraception and abortion and people cohabitating and divorced and remarried people receiving communion will be left up to the individual priest. Well, let me just say this, that although we as priests, we are not policemen. Okay, that's not our job. My job is not to go into your bedroom and, you know, shine a flashlight and, you know, say, oh, look at all those sex toys and, you know, look at all these bad things and naughty things that you're doing. You know, no, that's not what we do. However, we do have a sacred responsibility to do what? And this is where the argument falls completely apart. We have the obligation to tell you lay people, remind you lay people, of what the church authentically teaches. And so if the rules haven't changed, just because the Pope feels like, well, I don't want to change those rules because he can't. If he could, he probably would, but he can't, and I think he knows that. So what he thinks is, well, the poor, tired parish priest is not going to want to be bothered with this, and he's just going to let, you know, kind of a laissez-faire attitude. Well, that may happen. And I would say, in some ways, it has happened with contraception. And I want to talk about that just briefly, because a lot of people, this is where things are at. Paul the Sixth, see if I can find a picture of old Paul the Sixth here. I'll do it in post. But there's a picture of Paul the Sixth for you. A lot of people, you know, write about his life, and he was a very, if you will, I hate using the terms liberal conservative, because I think they don't really serve the purpose well. But he was progressive. He was opened to looking at, like Pope Francis seems to be, at changing where you can change some of the doctrines of the church or teaching of the church or disciplines of the church. And the big bugaboo issue of his day, now ours is, of course, the same-sex marriage, but his issue was contraception. We're talking 1960s, folks, 1968, the Summer of Love, Woodstock, you know, human fluids flowing freely, you know, at Woodstock, right, and all other places. Everybody having a grand old time. Okay, well, the problem was that, you know, he wanted to think, well, you know, maybe there's some room for the church to have a new understanding when it comes to artificial contraception. And he was very much in favor of that. And also, he was also in favor of opening up the priesthood to married men as well. And again, we actually do have some married priests. And again, that is a door that has been opened a bit. So it actually exists already. But as far as the artificial contraception issue came about, the irony is that here's this liberal, progressive Pope, Paul VI, and what does he do when he's trying to see, can the church allow for artificial contraception after consultation with his close circle of people, and that would include, you know, theologians, and good theologians, not just people that want to tell you what you want to hear, but people that are going to be objective, and he had to, in the end, listen and be obedient to what the church authentically teaches. And the church authentically teaches that contraception, there is no place whatsoever for contraception in regards to the sacrament of holy matrimony. It just doesn't work. It's a violation of that sacrament. It'd be like a priest consecrating pizza and beer. Boy, it sure would taste good. It would be completely invalid, okay? Wrong form to begin with. So, anyway, he writes this encyclical called Humani Vitae on human life, and basically it upholds and strengthens the authentic teaching of the church in regards to human sexuality and marriage. So, why is that? Well, because that's what the church has authentically teaches, and you can't escape that. And the problem is, even if a priest, even if a pope were to say, it's okay now for all these things that people want, I dare say that the written law of the Gospels, the church, the writings of the saints, you know, all of those would stand in witness against a modern understanding. It just doesn't fit. And even though somebody can tell you it's okay, you know in your heart, even if you don't like it, even if you don't agree with it, you know in your heart that it's wrong. So the law, in other words, is always going to be there, regardless of the Pope tries to sidestep it, or a bishop tries to sidestep it, or a priest or a deacon tries to sidestep it to make people feel better. Deep in our hearts, we know the truth. And that's always going to either confirm us or condemn us. So no appeal to any kind of quote-unquote authority, you know, that goes against the authority, that is the divinely revealed authority of God in the scriptures, in the traditions, in the sacred scriptures, in the writings of the saints, in the writings of the whole church fathers. All these things would be this great witness, this great tidal wave that would still say, sorry, no, nobody can change that. And that's the problem. So the problem is that, Béla Bartók?
Faux Transylvanian accent, proof shift.
Was that Béla
Bartók?
Béla Bartók?
Led by Thomas Zehetmeyer. Coming up.
Ah, well. Anyway, I think that sounds like Béla Bartók. Good Eastern European guy, right? Okay. So that's the issue at stake here, is that even though somebody can, you know, arbitrarily say it's okay now, how do you say that when the established teachings still say it's wrong? So this guy thinks that the individual priest will be the last guy to basically acquiesce and it'll be okay. Well, that's not going to work. Because if the Holy Father himself knows that he cannot contradict sacred scripture, the teachings of the church, the dogmas and doctrines and disciplines of the church, if the Holy Father himself knows that he can't do it, because if he could, he probably would try to. If he's not going to do that, which he, again, just like the women's ordination thing, he knows that he can't do that. So the bottom line is that the law, the teachings, they still will be in effect. Now, my analogy is simply this. You and I enjoy, I would say we enjoy, we don't really think of it as enjoying it. Maybe sometimes we do and sometimes we don't. People look at laws and rules and regulations as bad things. But let me submit to you that because of rules, laws, and regulations, and even etiquette, you and I get up every morning after we've had our coffee and maybe a pipe. We go, get in our vehicles, and we safely, for the most part, we go to our jobs. We do a day's work. On the way home, we get back into our car. We maybe stop off at the store or fast food restaurant, order a pizza, get some food. We get back into our cars, if we ever got out of them, and we drive back home where we enjoy a nice evening meal with our family and friends. And we do that because of the laws of the rules of the road. Now, it's granted, you're probably not running around with a copy of the California Driver's Handbook or the Minnesota Driver's Handbook or whatever state you live in and studying these laws and rules all the time. But once you've learned what they are, you, for the most part, you follow them, okay? It's when people usually try to have their own set of rules, that's when people, they endanger the lives of others. Okay, that's when accidents usually happen. Now, sometimes people make the wrong, they turn down the wrong one-way street like I've done a couple of times, and oh my gosh, it's a pretty scary feeling. But again, most people are trying to follow the rules of the road for their own safety and for the safety at large of all of the other citizens that are also using those roadways. So what I would like to submit to you, that even though you may not like some of the rules of the road, you might find them a little oppressive, by and large, they're there to bring order and stability to our daily lives. And for the most part, they do. And I believe that spiritually, you know, the message of the church is that the rules of the church bring peace. They bring peace to our hearts and our lives when we follow them the best we can. Does that mean that we're perfect? Does that mean we're going to become saints today? Please God, we did. But the bottom line is we are saints under construction. And sometimes we struggle. I know I do. Okay? And I'm sure you do too. But the wrong attitude to have is, well, I don't want to hear what the church has to say. I want to shut that voice off. And that's the problem that I see. And I'll close with this, is that too many people in our society today want to say, I don't want to hear that message. I don't want to hear the opposite view anymore. And we're going to try and silence that view. That's wrong. Okay? So maybe you don't agree. Maybe you don't agree with what I've said. Hey, free country. But I'm just telling you that part of the problem also comes about when people, they want to see this change, and they think they can force it through the use of the media or politics to force an institution or other people to change their view. I think that's misguided. I really do. And I think it brings a lot of frustration, needless frustration for the individual and for the group that they're opposing. I think the beautiful thing about being in this country is we still have the right to disagree. As long as we do it civilly and respectfully, I think that's a wonderful thing. I would not want to live in a world that everybody, you know, kind of says we all agree the same way, and isn't it wonderful? I don't think I want to live in that world, do you? Well, just because some people have different opinions, okay, you're entitled to your opinion. And I respect your right to disagree with me. And I hope that you can respect my right to maybe disagree with you. So anyway, I wanted to kind of, I told Gary I was going to maybe make a video about this. So I'm hoping that my thoughts made a little bit of sense to you. But regardless, I'm hoping that you have yourself a very blessed All Saints Day, happy All Hallows Eve, Halloween. And again, it'll be interesting. My next video, a little heads up. You probably saw, I'll probably reflash the video, that bowl of candy there. Yeah. Well, I'm still in ketosis, and I've got almost 2 months of ongoing continuous ketosis going on. Let's see if my next video, if I come on here with a sad face, kind of like the bad puppy dog look, you'll know that I gave in to some of that candy there. I love sweets. Fortunately, I don't have sugar cravings, but I still have a fondness for my sweet treats. My goal is to go up until Christmas week, and then I'm going to give myself possibly a little bit of a dispensation and indulge in some pumpkin pie and some treats for maybe a week. And then New Year's starting up again. But I'm going to see how 3 months of continuous ketosis takes me. And I just want to see how I feel, what I look like. So that's my goal. So I'm about two-thirds of the way there. So I'm really hoping to stay strong. So hopefully the next video I come on here, I'm still going to be in ketosis, and I won't have a backsliding candy fix. Okay? So we'll talk to you soon. Again, enjoy a Halloween pipe. You know, it might be a perfect autumnal evening to be on your porch and greet trick-or-treaters with a pipe and some candy and you know, goodies for the kids, and treat yourself as well. So, Holy Smoking Pipe Padre saying, light up your world, light up your Halloween night. God bless. Bye-bye. Now, did this work this time? I sure hope so.